How are we doing, folks? Your host Moose here on the Pitt Panthers Football Network as we welcome you back to our Season 6 2021 Week 7 Around the NCAA Recap Show. Your Pitt Panthers coming off an incredible come-from-behind victory over the UCLA Bruins. It was a top 10 showdown that lived up to the billing. What an incredible matchup. CJ Kirk putting the team on his back in the fourth quarter and leading the Panthers to victory, 38-37 over the Bruins. 21 fourth quarter points for the Panthers, 28 points in the second half. An incredible, incredible day. And really, one that was a bit of a conundrum of our own making. Of course, we had some turnovers that allowed UCLA to get some great plays, but we came through in the clutch when we needed to. CJ Kirk, the couple of touchdown passes in the fourth quarter, plus a touchdown run. Incredible day for him. And of course, he's the reason we end up winning. So, you know, as much as we want to be upset with the guy, three fourth quarter touchdown passes, a third quarter touchdown run. It was a great game for him. 376 yards passing for the Panthers. Of course, the big thing to keep an eye on there is the three turnovers, but UCLA had two of their own. The total yards in this game was absolutely incredible. Over 1,360 yards between the two teams. Over 1,100 yards of offense. Both teams over 550 yards of offense. Just an incredible day moving the football and, you know, one of the most explosive offensive performances we've seen in the entire history of this dynasty. Kirk, what a day for him. 376 yards passing, three touchdowns, three interceptions as well, which is a bit disappointing, and three sacks. So threes are wild there. But a great game for him regardless. Impressive ability of him to bounce back. 67 yards rushing as well. So over 400 total yards for CJ Kirk. Four touchdowns. What a day. Davion Reynolds didn't get as involved as we would have liked him to, but he was great rushing the football. 83 yards on just 12 carries, 6.9 yards a carry. London was at 4 yards a carry and did well also, so we kept doing what we typically do. Jay Keys had a rushing touchdown from our typical goal line set. He also caught a touchdown as well, 5 for 57. But the big storyline for us was the secondary receiving. Antonio Greer, possibly his best game ever as a Panther, 6 catches for 96 yards for the senior tight end. Paul Lease had 7 catches for 111 yards. We got Onyango, who's like our number 5, number 6 receiver. He had 4 catches for 38 yards and the game-winning touchdown after KJ Welsh left in the third quarter with an injury. Great game overall for our supplementary receivers. You had CJ London, 2 catches, including a huge catch on the fourth down or the fourth quarter game-winning drive. KJ Welsh still had 2 catches before he left. Caleb Cannon caught a touchdown pass. A great game overall for our receivers. Now, we still had a little bit of disappointment. Benjamin Ogden has really been invisible this season. One drop, didn't have a single catch for the senior, but hopefully we can get him back on track next week. Luke Davis, he's our backup center, but he's our starting left guard. 4 pancakes, did give up a sack, but a great game for him. 4 pancakes. Trey Brown, our third string center, came in, had one. Ryan Henry at right guard had a nice bounce back game, had a couple of pancakes as well. Very impressive performance from the line. Jacob Laughlin led the way with 10 tackles, though, to be honest, I didn't think he was great. He definitely missed a few big tackles, especially on one of Dwayne Meadows' huge runs. He completely missed a tackle, which was disappointing. We weren't great getting after the quarterback. We did have one late interception from Damian Vector. Ronnie Baker forced a fumble that Malachi Bordeaux was able to recover, but this has just not been a year for our pass rush to get after opposing quarterbacks. It's been very disappointing, especially coming off, you know, like the last 4 seasons, I think we've led the NCAA in sacks. This year, we're nowhere near the top of that leaderboard, and that's something that's a bit disappointing. We have good players. Ronnie Baker's 93 overall, but he just can't seem to get after the quarterback. Hopefully, we can rectify that moving forward. Defensively, we really struggled. Jacquez Mitchell passed all over us, 321 yards, 3 touchdowns. Did have one interception on the final play of the game, but otherwise, he pretty much did what he wanted throwing the football. And I think a lot of that stemmed from the fact that we had to sell out to try and stop the run because Dwayne Meadows was all over us. 23 carries, 217 yards, 9.4 a carry, had a 77-yarder. He also had a 59 yards on his first run of the game. So you take those two away, then maybe he's at 20 for like 100. That's still 5 yards a carry even without his 2 big runs. So we really struggled. We gave up a lot of big plays. Markel Wheeler had a 42-yard catch, 94 yards receiving. Justin Wright had a 45-yard grab. UCLA moved the ball really well, but we came up with one big stop really at the end, or two stops, I guess you could say, with the interception on the final drive. But we had the one big stop to get us the ball back and give us an opportunity to try and go win the game. But other than that, our defense was just horrendous. The fourth quarter, they finally showed up and just stopped UCLA enough that we can get an opportunity with the football. One thing we did well offensively was we kept Jacob Babineau out of the game. Their best player defensively, the sophomore outside linebacker, is an incredible player. He's an All-American already as a freshman. Incredible player. We kept him out of our way. Thankfully, he did have a sack, but he wasn't too impactful, which was very good. Marcus Johnson, 3-for-3 field goals. 33 was his long, but I just can't believe that UCLA did not try to set up a game-winning field goal there when they had 7 seconds left, a timeout, and the ball at like the 43-yard line. Get 7 yards, get 8 yards, give him an opportunity to try and make a 50-yard field goal to win the game. So an interesting strategy there by UCLA, and one that paid off handsomely for us, because not only did we get a victory, but we convinced a number of recruits, 6 recruits in fact, decided to sign with the Panthers following that victory. Probably the most notable of them for us, Roger Mobley, 73 overall athlete, is what he's projected at right now. We still have to scout some of these guys and see how they look, but very excited to get some of these signs. We fought off our heated rival West Virginia to sign David Davis, middle linebacker out of Reading, Ohio. We got Roger Mobley, athlete out of Langley Park, Maryland, so another big Maryland sign. We got Jordan Murphy Jr. already, the corner. Mobley's another guy that could play corner, he could play receiver, he could play safety. He's definitely got a lot of options as far as where we could use him throughout the lineup. Tommy Howard, a good free safety that we're able to sign as well. Good depth guy. Isaac Carter, 4-star tackle from Ohio. We fought off Penn State and Oklahoma State to sign him. Randy Miller, another big Maryland signing. 3 signings for Maryland here in this signing period so far. And Randy Miller, Perry Hall, number 15 defensive tackle in the country, is going to be great. We did also get a long snapper, Joe Weber. He's a tight end, but he's going to serve as our long snapper here moving forward because Bandino Moe will be graduating. We did miss out on a couple guys. Matt Petty decided to stay in Maryland and choose to go to the Naval Academy. And Aaron John, 5'10", 176, 4-star speedster receiver from Gainesville, Florida, chooses to go to the pass-happy offense that is SMU. Now, if we look at our players, we got David Davis, of course. We can finish scouting him, and we see he's a 72 overall, 80 speed for a middle linebacker, very good acceleration, and he's well-rounded. Take a look at all of his stats. They're all in the mid-70s, so he's a guy that just can do it all, and we can kind of spot him throughout the lineup wherever we might need to. Mobley, we get our initial scouting report on him. His carrying's okay. His catching's still a C. We have to see where that is, but his man coverage is 83. His zone coverage is 84, so I like what he can do there. Elusiveness is an 82. If his catching is good, maybe he could play receiver, but he projects, I think, on the defensive side of the football as it stands right now. Tommy Howard at free safety, he's got good speed, 89. Hit power is okay. His coverage skills are really lacking for what we might want him to do, so he'll probably be an in-the-box type of player. He's a tackler. He gets after the football. He's in run coverage. He might even be a guy that in the future projects as a safety to outside linebacker conversion like Quell Hampshire was this year, just because his coverage skills are not there just yet, so we'll see how he progresses. Isaac Carter, unfortunately, his run blocking got a real decrease, and so we have to see what his final rating is. He's a 4-star, so we hadn't scouted him at all, but halfway through, he's -4, and that's not looking like a great signing. Randy Miller, 4-star defensive tackle, though, looks very, very solid, good strength. We got to wait and see if any of his other ratings, hopefully that tackle rating's a little bit better than a D, but otherwise, very solid player so far, projected at a 74. And Joe Weber, doesn't really matter what he's projected at. We didn't sign him for his overall. He's going to be the long snapper. Maybe, hopefully, he has a little bit of speed. Matt Petty, projected 67 overall, so not a horrific player to miss out on, but he's going to be a good solid contributor for Navy, I'm sure, in a few years. Aaron Jean goes to SMU. I know he's got fantastic speed. It's going to be somewhere in the neighborhood of 95 speed, something like that, but he's a huge contradiction because he's got all the speed in the world, no hands whatsoever, 58 catching, so he's going to be brutal in terms of that regard, but still would have liked him on the roster. Jordan Murphy Jr., we get our final scouting report of him in, and he's a beast. 79 overall, 93 speed, 86 man coverage, 85 press. He's a guy that I think will be on the outside maybe next season already. He's got press ability, he's got man coverage ability, he's got speed. That means he can play on the outside, play against some of the top receivers in the country, and I like him to contribute already for us. So we've done a great job. We've got a big recruiting class in already. I think we now have, 12 signings? And we had, I think, 19, maybe 20 open scholarships. So we still have plenty of space to bring in some more players. And we do have a few big ones that we are targeting. But for right now, we're very happy with what we've been able to do in our signing class. So let's take a look at how other teams around the country are feeling. Clemson got a big victory in double overtime with the game-winning touchdown from Anthony Riggs, their halfback, to hold off Louisville 37-34. Big win for Clemson to stay in the ACC hunt. Virginia Tech goes to 5-0 with a 31-24 victory over Georgia Tech. It was a game of 28 points in the second quarter, only 3 points in the second half, and Virginia Tech gets the win and stays unbeaten. NC improves to 5-1 with a win over struggling Wake Forest. Boston College to 5-0 with a game-winning field goal in the fourth quarter. They win 26-24 over UVA. Boston College has been very, very good this season, and they are probably the surprise of the ACC right now. Syracuse beats NC State to go to 4-2. They're also a big surprise this year, while Duke struggling gets blown out by Texas. Around the country, Washington with the win of the week, other than the Pitt game, of course, 48-12. That is a statement victory over previously unbeaten Stanford. Thurman was horrific for the Cardinal. 2 interceptions, didn't even pass for 100 yards, while Pearson, well, you have a bunch of touchdowns, passed for like 390 yards for Washington. Incredible day for him. We were worried he might lose his starting job to Tristan Richards, the backup quarterback. Instead, he comes out and has an incredible performance. Another guy that had an incredible performance, Steve Tate, Michigan's starting quarterback. They finally found a competent quarterback. Michigan was terrible last year. I think they finished, 6-7, 7-6? This year, they're unbeaten, and that's on the strength of the best quarterback, arguably, in college football in terms of throwing the football. Steve Tate, 7 touchdowns, incredible game, huge win over Maryland. Georgia beats Mizzou. Kentucky, surprising blowout of Cal, 56-14 over the Golden Bears. Remember, that was a team that was poised to make the college football playoff last season, just missed out, and now they're getting blown out by Kentucky. Florida knocks off Vandy. LSU wins. Oklahoma, easy work with UL Monroe. Tennessee, 45-23 over UCF. Notre Dame, 38-24 over a decent Michigan State team. Ole Miss had their hands full with a winless Auburn team, playing for basically pride is all they had to play for this season, and they took Ole Miss to double overtime. Dustin Young and crew nearly knocked from the ranks of the unbeaten yet again. They went to overtime earlier this season with Alabama. Now they go to overtime with Auburn. Those Alabama schools really giving Ole Miss trouble, but Ole Miss comes away with another huge, huge victory. And this is a wild game. Gaither only had 9 completions for Auburn. 4 of them were touchdowns for the freshman. And look at some of these stat lines. Horn, 3 touchdowns, 7 catches. Dustin Young, 2 touchdown passes, passed for 215 yards. He did run for a touchdown as well. Leonard ran for 4 for Ole Miss. And take a look at these receiving stats. I don't even know if they're real or not, but Jefferson, 14 catches, 2 touchdowns, 204 yards. He basically caught every pass that Dustin Young threw. Pravon Dean, who was in the Heisman race, completely kept off the score sheet. So a crazy game there, but Ole Miss stays unbeaten and will stay number one in the country. Oregon State also fought off an overtime challenge. They got the victory over Arizona State, 44-37. So what a slate of games around the country, and some great performances. NCAA Player of the Week was Tommy Fuller. Offensively, passed for 534 yards as Western Kentucky beat Troy. He had nearly as many touchdowns as incompletions, 6 touchdowns. Kevin Terry, big game for Eastern Michigan as well in their victory over Akron. Sack, forced a fumble, and a pick. So a big day for the senior outside linebacker. In the ACC, Pitt claiming both defensive and offensive player of the week. CJ Kirk, player of the week, freshman player of the week, offensive player of the week, 376 yards passing, 67 rushing, 4 touchdowns, of course, 3 turnovers, but people don't remember that when you come away with the victory. Damian Vector, I thought his was a little ridiculous. All he did was have an interception, and he ends up with defensive player of the week for the victory over UCLA. That one seemed a little easy going for me, but we'll take it nonetheless. Steve Tate, huge game in the Big Ten, 7 touchdowns, 483 yards passing, and Wally Reese, big game for Rutgers as they knock off Iowa in an upset. He had 14 tackles, 9 for loss, and 3 sacks. What a game for the senior defensive end. Absolutely incredible performance. In the Big 12, Blake Anderson, 200 yards rushing, 3 touchdowns. Big game for the TCU senior as they beat Oklahoma State. Pretty impressive performance. Over in the Independents, Josh Miles filling in for injured running back David Coleman. Remember, he just destroyed us last season. 201 yards and two touchdowns on 40 carries for the sophomore halfback who's filling in for the injured star. In the MAC, an even more impressive rushing performance. Leroy Garcia, the junior running back for Ohio, 52 carries for 309 yards and four touchdowns, 6 yards a carry for 50 carries and four touchdowns in the victory over Ball State. Unbelievable performance for the Ohio running back. And something I thought was absolutely crazy, Keith Williams is a tight end. He is starting at quarterback for the Georgia Bulldogs. They are down that far in their quarterback rotation. Remember, Carter Ford is injured. Mark Bush, their backup senior quarterback, is injured. And Jack Nicholson transferred to Missouri before the season, their other senior quarterback. So they're missing their starter, who's a sophomore. Keith Williams, the tight end, is filling in at quarterback. And he has 4 total touchdowns and leads them to a victory over Mizzou. He played quarterback in high school. He's back there now as a junior. Crazy that he's taken over for Georgia and actually led them to a victory, which was just ridiculous. Heisman race, Dustin Young still atop. Ian Welsh from Army. Could be the first guy from Army to win the Heisman. Who knows how long. Another guy to watch out for, Travis Huff. Big performance in the win over Georgia Tech. He's going to be taking on your Pitt Panthers this week. This didn't make any sense to me. It said Pravon Dean had 4 catches for 155 yards against Auburn. But when we looked at the stats, he didn't have any catches. I don't know what to believe. Either way, his teammate Dustin Young, definitely more formidable chance to win the Heisman for number one Ole Miss, who stays number one. We don't see a ton of movement. The top five stays the same. Pitt jumps up to number 6 from 8 after beating previous number 6 UCLA, who drops to 13. Washington beats previously number 7, I think they were, Stanford, who falls back to 15. Washington jumps up to number 7, so it's swapping spots after some of those victories. Virginia Tech's up to number 8 after their victory against Georgia Tech. They're still unbeaten. Michigan's up to 9. Clemson falls to 10. Texas back to 11. Cincinnati still unbeaten at 4-0, jumps up to number 12. So, of course, this is where you start to see the unbeatens come forward. UCLA falls back to 13, like we mentioned. Stanford back to 15. Interesting note that both the teams that beat them took their exact spot in the rankings. So that was kind of wild. Boston College up to number 18. They'll play Louisville this week. That should be a great game. You got Arkansas State just kind of hiding back there at number 19, 4-0. Iowa State's into the top 25 as they are 5-0. They're number 24 in the country. They just escaped Baylor, and they got a huge game with unbeaten number 3 Houston this week. And USC's finishes out the top 25, currently sitting 4-2. Cal and Louisville, the two teams to drop out after losses this past week. So if we look at the ACC standings, right now, three-horse race. You got Virginia Tech, Pitt, and North Carolina have all looked very impressive this season and have multiple conference wins. Duke has their only conference game. They got a victory, but I don't think anybody thinks Duke is in with a chance. Miami at 2-1 could maybe play their way in if they win out, because then they'll, you know, get some tiebreakers over some other teams, but they did lose to Virginia Tech already this season, so they'll need Virginia Tech to lose for them to have any opportunity at the ACC title. They'll need a little bit of chaos. Over in the Atlantic, they've already got chaos. Boston College is the only team with an undefeated conference record, and they've only played one game. Clemson, I think, still has to be considered the favorite. After losing, they lost to Virginia Tech, who's not on their division, which means if Clemson wins out, they'll be undefeated against the Atlantic side of the division, and they'll have all the tiebreakers and will certainly be back in the ACC championship game for, I think it's been every single year of this dynasty. Clemson's been there. No, there was one year they didn't make it when NC State made it and Pitt beat them. Otherwise, it's been Clemson all 5 years of this dynasty so far. Your Pitt Panthers have been in there for 4 of those years as well. So it's been a bit one-sided as far as the teams that make the conference championship. But this year is definitely shaping up to be potentially a completely different year. Virginia Tech's in for the mix. North Carolina's in for the mix. Miami's always in the mix. Boston College is in the mix. Plenty of teams around that should make for a great slate of games. And, of course, a huge game, Pitt-Virginia Tech, that we'll talk about in just a bit. Pac-12, big game. UCLA taking on Oregon State. The Bruins will look to bounce back after losing to your Pitt Panthers last week. I think they get back on track against the Beavers. Tennessee takes on South Carolina. South Carolina is always a tough team. They make the SEC championship game a few times. They were in it just this past season, and I think they'll give Tennessee a good run for their money. Texas taking on SMU. They've been so bad since joining the Big 12. This year, unfortunately, it's a down year for SMU. Tough year for them to join the Big 12. They're really struggling. Cincinnati looks to stay unbeaten against a decent Navy squad. I like Cincinnati in this one, but it should be a good game. North Carolina, Miami is going to be a big game in ACC Coastal Division play. Arkansas, Bama. Bama's looking to play spoiler at this point. They've got two SEC losses already. Arkansas's 3-0 in SEC play. Bama's actually going to be the team that's the, not the underdog, they're still the favorite, but as far as SEC championship opportunities, Bama's the team on the outside looking in. One of the biggest games of the week, Iowa State, are they for real as they take on number 3 Houston? Houston, remember, was a playoff team last year. They're now in the Big 12. They won their first Big 12 game last week. I like Iowa State in this one. I like Michael Robinson, the quarterback they have. I think he's fantastic. He's a game changer. I think he could lead them to victory. Stanford, Notre Dame, game of the week. A little bit ridiculous that it's game of the week and not Pitt, Virginia Tech, but that's the way NCAA always goes. I don't know if I've ever seen a user team get game of the week. This one, it's Stanford, Notre Dame. That's a game that's usually saved for later in the season. Should be a great matchup, though. Two very, very good teams. Stanford, of course, their first loss last week. We'll be taking on a Notre Dame team that can pass the ball all over the field. Stanford pass defense is terrible. Because of that, I like Notre Dame in this one. Vanderbilt, Georgia. I think Carter Ford might come back this week for Georgia at quarterback. We'll see. So I like them to beat Vandy. Florida, Georgia State. We got Rutgers, Michigan, Clemson, Duke. So some weak games there. Washington, Arizona as well. And finally, your Pitt Panthers taking on the Virginia Tech Hokies in what we deem the game of the week. Herb Street likes the Hokies, and it's hard to go against. They've been very, very impressive. Number 7 scoring offense in the country. Their offense has been very efficient. Number 1 defense in the country. Number 2 rush defense, only behind your Pitt Panthers. Number 6 pass defense, which is very, very impressive. The only area where both of these teams have been really bad is turnover differential. Virginia Tech protects the ball a little bit better than Pitt, but not very well in general. So whoever is able to create more turnovers and have less turnovers of their own will likely be the winner in this game. CJ Kirk, 12 touchdowns against 13 interceptions. That INT number has to come down if the Panthers want to improve to 6-1. This week. Davion Reynolds, you'd like to see him get more opportunities with the football. He's averaging about 10 carries, 11 carries a game. Like to see him get a bit more. Same with Jay Keys, to be honest. Get him more touches of the football. Virginia Tech led by Travis Huff, 13 TDs against 2 INTs. He's been fantastic. He can run the ball as well. BJ Manning's been very good at running back. He's actually their backup. Their starter, Eddie Henderson, has been injured for most of the season. Manning's filled in admirably. And Ryan Winston's one of the most dangerous receivers in the ACC. He's more of a possession type guy, but he's a fantastic player who's definitely going to be playing in the NFL next season. Virginia Tech 5-0 this year. They blew out two brutal teams in Wyoming and Akron, but then they've been still impressive since then. 41-21 over Clemson. That's Clemson's only loss. Had a couple of tight games since then, but they've been very good overall. They will be missing some good players, though. Zach Lindsay, one of their nickel corners, is out with an abdominal tear. And then Eddie Henderson, pulled groin. He's not expected to play today. He's their starting running back. He ran for over 1,000 yards last season. Not expected to play in this game. But even without him, this is a very, very good Virginia Tech team. A lot of talent across the board and a lot of depth, you see, as we go on their roster. They have a lot of high-rated players. They're very, very solid. They're not overwhelming, but they're still very good. Like, I think on overall talent, I believe our overall rating's a bit better than theirs. But they have talent in all the key areas, and one area where they're very, very good. Travis Huff, the senior, finally getting an opportunity to play. This guy can run 56 yards a game rushing the football. He's a good enough passer, 88 power, 88 accuracy, but where he really can make his money, 90 speed. So you got to watch him. He's got 90 elusiveness. He can scramble when he needs to. He is a scrambler. And their backup even is a scrambler, Steve Love. So Virginia Tech riding with a quarterback who can get out into space and make things happen. That's where Huff is going to be particularly dangerous. The Panthers are going to have to watch him. BJ Manning at running back, he's honestly maybe an upgrade because he has good speed. Of course, Henderson was good last year, 1,138 yards rushing. But I don't remember him doing much against the Panthers. I'd have to look back at the stats. But I don't think he did much. I like Manning, though. He's got a little bit more speed, a little bit more elusiveness, and he can do very, very well for Virginia Tech. So I think he's going to be a good player. Jason Young will be backing him up. He's more of a power back, and they got Braylon Perry as well. But Manning will be the guy to tote the rock primarily through the games today. Their receiving core, very, very good top-end players. Ryan Winston and Jakari Thomas are an excellent complement for each other. Winston, the possession guy, he catches everything thrown to him, while Thomas has that incredible speed. They also have Ray Harris, probably a bit snubbed feeling, the Bethel Park area guy, Pittsburgh guy. He's very disappointed that he didn't get to play for his hometown Panthers, and he's probably going to try and make them pay. That said, Thomas and Winston are an incredible combo. Jakari Thomas, they're finally making use of his speed. Look at that, 4 touchdowns already, 18 yards a catch. He's a guy that can stretch the field, take the top off the defense. He's a fantastic player. While Winston, 6 touchdowns, 36 catches, 12 yards per catch, because he is that possession guy and he's very, very good at it. Michael Atkinson, a freshman tight end. They usually do like to use their tight end. BJ Woods was their starting tight end last season. Atkinson's good, huge body, but I don't expect him to be much more than a decoy today, as Winston, Harris, and Thomas are going to be the guys to get the ball for certain. Offensive line for Virginia Tech is probably their weakest point. They're not particularly great. Eric Chandler's a fantastic left guard, but otherwise they're fairly weak across the board. Matt Mason at center's not particularly good. Charles Boone at right guard's okay. Right tackle, Curtis Tootens, is not great. So I think this would be one time we talked about how much our defensive line has struggled this year to get after the quarterback, especially in the last couple of weeks. I think this is a week that they can finally potentially get after the quarterback. The only thing that hinders them is that even though Virginia Tech's line isn't particularly good, they do have a very elusive quarterback who can get away from that pressure. That said, on the other side of the ball, Virginia Tech's got an incredible defensive line. Brandon Hamby's very, very good. Ricky Silva's very good. Steve Walker and Jeremy Allen in the middle of the defensive line are fantastic players. So that's going to be the biggest test for the Panthers, is who can win this game in the trenches, because, of course, Virginia Tech, fantastic defensive line. Pitt has an offensive line that could counter them. And so that'll be a very interesting matchup to see who comes out victorious in that one. Jeremy Jones, outside linebacker, is a solid player. John Davis in the middle of the field is just a gigantic behemoth, 6'2", 260. And Ashley's a quick player at middle linebacker as well, who can make a lot of things happen. Kylan Howard's an interesting player. The redshirt sophomore starts at outside linebacker. He's a bit undersized, not a great player, but he's very quick. He can get around the field and make a ton of plays, so watch out for him. James Brown at corner, he's feeling good. He's a good, solid player. They also have Rodney Wilkinson, who's a fantastic player. I like him a lot. Lindsay's a really well-rounded player, fifth-year senior. He's a captain of that defense. He'll be making the trip, of course, but he will not be playing, so he'll have to be more of a vocal leader for them, for the young guys like DeAndre Baker, who will actually be playing in the game. Dane Davis, a very good senior free safety. They got Thomas behind him as well. So they have some depth. I really like what Virginia Tech has defensively, and I think they're a team that is just deep and can make a lot of people pay. They're not, again, they don't have a ton of superstars. You don't see a lot of 95 overalls on this defense, but you don't see a lot of bad players either, and I think that's going to make them very, very tough to deal with. And they got some great kickers. Earl Walker and Henderson at punter are fantastic. It's a very well-rounded Virginia Tech team. That's why they've been so good this season. They blew out Clemson, and they can certainly give us some trouble. There's no doubt about that. So let me know in the comments, what will happen? Will your Pitt Panthers continue on the quest for another ACC title, or will Virginia Tech prove to be a worthy challenger in the ACC Coastal Division this year? As always, let me know in the comments. Let me know what you think about all of the signings we've got. Which recruit are you most excited to see next season? And as always, guys, thank you so much for watching. Hail to Pitt. We'll see you soon. Take care. Bye-bye.